One. And we are live. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Aiman Azlan. Welcome to YouTube Live. I apologize. This is unprecedented. I did not announce this YouTube Live because I just stole this time, basically. So my wife and my wife and my son are away for a while. So I have this free time. So I thought, what should I do with this free time? I have this. So this thing, if you don't know, if you follow me for a while, you might know. These are questions that I receive from students, from people, from public talks that I've given in universities and elsewhere. So the questions that I could not answer, I store them in this pink can here. So because it's been in this can for such a long time, I figured it's time for me to answer as many as I can in one YouTube live event. So I think that'll be easier and that'll be fair for people. But before that, I want to say something about questions. I hear a lot of, especially young people, and not just young people, people, when they have questions, one of the things that prevents them from asking the question is their belief that the question is stupid. And I'm sure that you might have this thought once in a while. I do sometimes. So you want to ask this question, it's really bothering you, but then you think to yourself, it sounds like a stupid question. And if I ask this question, people will say that I'm stupid, and then people will judge me, they will laugh, ha ha ha, and so on. So you end up not asking the question. Sounds familiar? Yeah. So before this, once upon a time, I have this idea that there is no such thing as a stupid question. That's what I said. There's no such thing as a stupid question. But now I want to change that perspective. Now I want to change that. Well, after some thought, it's not like I'm changing it randomly. After some thought, I want to change that to, yes, there is such a thing as a stupid question, but you have the right to ask it. And at the very least, when you ask your stupid question, you get to find out if it is really stupid or not. Because if you don't ask that stupid question, then you are in a zone where you keep on wondering, is this a stupid question? Is it not a stupid question? Because if you ask that stupid question, one of two things can happen. Number one, you found out it's not a stupid question because somebody else out there has the same question and that question is bothering them as well. So that's good. Because not only are you helping yourself by asking the question, you're helping somebody else who has the same question, but then doesn't have the courage to ask the question like you do. So that's the first thing that could happen. Second thing that could happen, yeah, people might laugh. People might say it's a stupid question. But is that a bad thing? I would argue no, if you know how to look at it in a different way. It's not a stupid question. It's not a bad thing because now you know for sure, this is a stupid question. Because yes, some questions are not formulated in the right way. All right? It's not formulated in the right way. But you don't know whether or not it's formulated in the right way until you ask that question. So it is very important for you to know that stupid ke tak stupid ke, just ask the question. Ask the question. You have the right to ask your stupid question. And that takes courage. And I think fundamentally is the issue here. It's not about the stupid question, if you really think about it. It's more about courageousness and confidence to ask the question. Just ask the question. And that's one part. The other part I wanted to say is for people who are receiving the question, like say if you are a motivator or you are a public speaker and somebody, or you are a teacher, parent, whoever, and somebody asks you this question, The worst thing that you can do is laugh. Trust me, the worst thing that you can do is laugh. Yeah, some questions are stupid. Some questions are ridiculous, but they are ridiculous and stupid to you. You have no idea how this question is affecting the person who is asking that question. Maybe this question is something that this person is struggling with for months and months, maybe years, I don't know. And only today does this person have the courage to ask the question. And then you laugh. Just imagine how it feels to be that person. So I just want to get that perspective across for the person who's asking the question and also for the person who is receiving the question, who is answering the question. So both needs to play its their part. But all in all, it's all about you and your individual action, basically. So I don't want you to come away from this little talk of mine and thinking that you have to blame the other person. No, just look at yourself. If you have a question, look at yourself and ask yourself, am I courageous enough to ask this question? Because this question is bothering me. I should ask. And if you are a person who is answering question, ask yourself, have I ever laughed to the face of somebody who is asking me a sincere question? And evaluate whether or not you are on the right path or otherwise. Having said that, let's go through the questions. Okay, I have no idea how many months, maybe years, I don't know, that I have kept these questions in here. I apologize if you have ever like asked me a question and I haven't answered them yet. It's not like I don't want to. I appreciate your question. That's why I keep them. I don't throw them away. But it's just a matter of like finding the time to answer the question. So if you want like a quick answer from me, my advice would be to ask me directly. What do I mean by that? Well, if you attend one of my talks if you attend one of my talks, it's advisable for you to ask me directly. Go to the microphone and ask me directly, because I will give the people who is courageous enough to ask live the priority to ask questions. I'm not saying that you who are writing are not courageous, but obviously, if you're able to like expose yourself to the audience expose your vulnerability to the audience, obviously you should get more credit lah. Okay, I'm gonna like mix Malay and English because all these questions, they're not all in English. So, salam bang. Waalaikumsalam. Saya nak tanya boleh?
Boleh.
Abang boleh tak bagi tips macam mana nak tentukan apa yang patut diprioritikan dengan apa yang tak patut diprioritikan? Okay, so the question is about priority. Alright, macam mana kita nak tentukan apakah priority yang atas dan apakah priority yang bawah? Antara cara yang terbaik pada pendapat saya untuk nak tentukan priority kehidupan adalah pertama sekali, you kena tanya diri you sendiri, apakah panduan utama kehidupan you. What do I mean by that? Maksudnya, bila you nak buat apa-apa sahaja dalam kehidupan ini, apakah panduan utama yang you rujuk sebelum buat benda tu? Alright? Adakah you rujuk nafsu? Adakah you rujuk agama? Adakah you rujuk mak ayah? Adakah you rujuk undang-undang? Adakah you rujuk budaya? Adakah you rujuk kawan-kawan? So, whatever answer to this question, I want to know the ultimate punya rujukan. Ultimate rujukan. Ultimate rujukan ni maksud dia like kalau you gali dalam diri you tu yang paling dalam lah, apakah dia punya teras dia? Apakah rujukan teras dalam kehidupan you? And itu dipanggil prinsip kehidupan. Dan daripada prinsip kehidupan itu, barulah you dapat tahu macam mana you nak letakkan priority-priority yang sebetulnya mengikut kepada prinsip you. So first you kena ada prinsip dulu. Kalau tak ada prinsip, macam mana nak tentukan priority? Sebab priority ni dia berbeza-beza mengikut prinsip kita macam mana. Contoh, kalau kita punya panduan kehidupan adalah nafsu semata-mata, kita hanya ikut apa yang kita suka nak buat aje, maka priority dia lain. Priority dia adalah apa sahaja yang memberi keseronokan, aku buat dulu. apa sahajanya memberikan kesakitan, aku jauhkan diri. Itu kalau you gunakan nafsu sebagai panduan hidup. Dan panduan hidup tu pada pendapat saya bukanlah panduan hidup terbaik, sebab tak semua benda yang you suka adalah baik untuk you in the long term, dan tak semua benda yang you tak suka adalah tidak baik untuk you in the long term. So, berbalik kepada soalan asal, apakah prinsip you? You tahu prinsip you, you tahu macam mana nak susun you punya prioriti kehidupan. Okay? Alright. Eh, ada orang tulis dekat chat lah. Hi bro! Hi! XDRNNSY. Sedap nama kau. Asim Horan. Hi brother, I got your book. Thank you for getting my book. I hope you enjoy reading it as well. Assalamualaikum. Waalaikumsalam Hafizuddin. Are you aware of race and IQ? What? Are you aware of race and IQ? Yeah, I'm aware. But I don't get your point though. Anyway, teruskan dengan soalan lain. Okay. Macam mana nak tegur parents apa yang dia orang buat tu salah tapi dengan cara yang baik tanpa mengguriskan hati mereka? Okay. Ho, soalan ni famous. Macam mana nak tegur parents tanpa mengguriskan hati mereka? Okay. First of all, you kena teliti betul-betul dulu. Apa yang parents you buat tu salah pada... salah berdasarkan apa? Okay. Adakah salah berdasarkan nafsu you? Contohnya, dia buat benda you tak suka. Adakah tu dasar dia? Ataupun dia salah berdasarkan undang-undang? Ataupun salah berdasarkan agama? Salah berdasarkan apa? So, you kena figure out dulu, salah dia tu salah pada dasarnya apa? Kalau salah pada dasar agama, okay. Kalau salah pada dasar undang-undang, okay. Kalau salah pada dasar nafsu, you kena macam selidik balik. Okay. Patut ke aku tegur dalam keadaan macam ni? Katakanlah salah dia tu adalah salah yang betul-betul salah lah. Katakan salah dari segi undang-undang ke atau salah dari segi agama. Alright, ni macam betul-betul salah. Moralitinya memang tak betul. Tidak patut dibuat lah benda tu. So, macam mana you nak tegur sebagai seorang anak? Okay. Dan soalan dia adalah macam mana nak tegur tanpa mengguriskan hati diorang. Alright, so jawapan saya mungkin tak berapa orang suka. Tapi inilah jawapan yang saya fikirkan berdasarkan apa yang saya tahu tentang psikologi manusia, apa yang saya faham tentang psikologi manusia dan juga dalam pengalaman saya sendiri, ini apa yang saya percayalah. Number one, you tidak boleh nak menegur orang tanpa mengguriskan hati dia. Kenapa? Kerana by definition, menegur tu maksud dia you nak kata you sedang buat benda salah. Itulah message di sebalik teguran. You sedang buat benda salah. Dan manusia naturally dia tak suka nak dengar bila dia buat benda salah. You tak suka, saya pun tak suka. So nak tak nak dia akan teguris juga hati dia. Okay? So kalau you punya goal you adalah tak nak guriskan hati parent, nasihat saya, ikut je lah apa parent nak. Tapi adakah itu satu jalan yang terbaik untuk you dan juga parents? Kena fikir tu. Kalau you just ikut je apa parents nak. Ikut je. Sebab itulah cara terbaik kalau you tak nak guriskan hati mereka. Tetapi, walaupun begitu, tidak ada garanti yang you takkan guriskan hati diorang juga. Sebab kadang-kadang you cuba nak ikut. Nak ikut apa parents nak. Ikut apa parents nak. Tapi lalah kali, diorang tak puas hati juga. Sebab manusia macam itulah. Macam mana pun you tak boleh nak puaskan hati semua orang setiap masa selama-lamanya. So, kalau you nak tegur, you tak boleh nak lari daripada guriskan hati dia orang. Tapi apa you boleh buat adalah you boleh minimumkan kadar gurisan hati itu dengan menggunakan adab yang betul. Menggunakan adab yang betul. So, jangan kurang ajar. Jangan jerit ke, jangan tengking, jangan guna perkataan kasar-kasar. Gunakan cara yang paling lembut yang you tahu, paling lembut yang you mampu buat berdasarkan kepada personaliti orang yang you nak cakap tu. Dalam kes ni, you punya mak ayah lah. So, you kena kenal lah mak ayah you macam mana. So, apakah cara terbaik nak masuk hati dia orang tu? Sebab lain orang, lain style. Kalau you pun tak apa kenal mak ayah you, tak apa kenal dia punya hati budi, tak apa kenal dia punya style, then itu satu masalah lah. Dan percayalah, walaupun mak ayah yang style garang-garang ni pun, tidak bermaksud hati dia tidak lembut. Okay, kadang-kadang kat luar je macam tu, tapi dalam dia lain. Alright, saya bagi contoh. Cikgu saya pernah bagi tahu satu cerita yang mana dia seorang, dia anak perempuan dan ayah dia seorang yang garang. Garang gila, memang style protektif lah kepada anak perempuan dia ni. Sampai ke tahap nak keluar rumah pun payah. Sebab dia terlalu protektif dan garang. Tapi entah macam mana dia berjaya juga pujuk hati ayah dia untuk ke universiti. Tapi susah, bukan senang nak pujuk ayah dia nak pergi universiti ni sebab dia tak bagi. Dia betul-betul protektif kepada anak dia ni. Tapi dia pergi universiti dan dia belajar psikologi. Alright, dan dalam pembelajaran psikologi tu dia boleh faham mekanisme manusia dan dia applykan apa yang dia belajar kepada ayah dia. Dan dia sedar yang ada kemungkinan yang ayah dia macam tu bukan sebab ayah dia kejam ke, bukan sebab ayah dia ni jahat ke, mesti ada something yang menyebabkan ayah dia macam tu. So dia balik rumah dan dia tanya mak dia. Dia tanya mak dia soalan ni, dia yang dia tak pernah terfikir nak tanya mak dia. So dia tanya mak dia, dia kata, "Mak, kenapa ayah macam tu?" Ah, tu dia. 19 tahun hidup tak pernah terfikir nak tanya ayah, nak tanya soalan tu. So mak dia mula cerita macam mana ayah dia kecil-kecil dulu, macam mana ayah dia dibesarkan, apakah kondisi kehidupan ayah dia pada waktu tu. And time tu lah dia faham rupa-rupanya, oh sebab tu lah ayah dia ada personality macam tu. Kerana waktu kecil-kecil dia tu, dia macam tok dia pun jenis yang garang juga. So dia macam transfer dekat ayah dia. Tapi sebenarnya ayah dia tu jenis yang sayang, tapi sayang dia tu, dia cara dia tunjuk sayang adalah dengan garang. Sebab dia tidak pernah tahu cara lain untuk sayang. Mak ayah dia tak pernah ajar cara lain untuk sayang. Bukan nak salahkan mak ayah dia, mak ayah dia pun tak tahu. Yelah kan, bukan semua orang belajar psikologi, betul tak? So bila dia dengar cerita daripada mak dia ni, dia pun jadi sedar, oh ayah aku ni sebenarnya sayang kat aku. Selama ni dia tak diingatkan ayah dia macam apa, hati busuk ke apa ke, Allahu alam lah kan. Tapi dia tak perasan yang sebenarnya itu cara ayah dia nak sayang. So dia buat eksperimen. So waktu cuti balik daripada universiti, dia bersama dengan mak ayah dia, keluarga dia dan semua-semua, and then dia nak balik ke universiti pula kan. Waktu dekat pintu rumah tu, nak salam dengan mak dia, nak salam dengan ayah dia kan. Dia salam mak dia, salam dia beradik dia kan. Dia salam ke ayah dia, bok, dia cium pipi ayah dia, lepas tu dia belah. Tak pernah buat benda tu. Semua orang terkejut macam, what? So dia belah. Dia belah, pergi kat bas, ciao. Dia betul kata-kata pasal dia tak pernah buat benda tu. Tak pernah selama ni dia buat benda tu, cium pipi ayah dia. So dia balik. And then dalam bas tu, kakak dia call, dia kata, "Woi, kau gila ke apa? Asal kau buat macam tu kat ayah?" So dia macam, "Aku tak tahu, aku saja nak try something." So okay, 2-3 hari lepas tu, dia call mak dia, dia kata, "Mak, hari tu kan, Angah ada cium pipi ayah. Ayah ada kata apa-apa ke?" So mak dia kata, "Sebenarnya ayah kau cakap dekat aku yang pertama kali dalam kehidupan yang aku rasa disayangi." Wow. So, point dia adalah jangan kita nak judge seseorang tu just by dia punya personality. Kadang-kadang kita tak tahu personality dia tu datang daripada mana. Dan kadang-kadang kita tak sedar cara orang sayang tu dia berbeza-beza. Bergantung kepada cara dia dibesarkan, cara dia dididik lah. Panjang pula jawapan kepada soalan tu. Okay. Assalamualaikum. Waalaikumsalam. Macam mana nak buat bila kita dah nak start study tapi time tu kita penat, mengantuk sampai tak jadi nak study? Okay. Study ni adalah sesuatu yang memerlukan tenaga otak. So kalau you letih, minta maaf, memang payahlah nak study. Trust me, payah nak. Kalau you cram sekalipun, nak baca sebiji buku teks sehari sebelum exam, scientifically speaking, peratusan yang you boleh ingat tu amat low. So apa yang saya nasihatkan adalah make sure you dapat rehat yang secukupnya. Saya tak nak cakap you kena tidur 8 jam ke, 7 jam ke, 6 jam ke. Saya tak nak cakap benda tu. Apa yang saya nak cakap adalah rehat secukupnya. Jangan kurang dan jangan lebih. Ah, lebih pun masalah juga. Rehat secukupnya. Rehat secukupnya. Make sure you ada schedule, make sure you ada jadual, make sure you design hari yang you nak. So jadual tu adalah satu tool, alat yang you boleh gunakan untuk design hari yang you nak. So bayangkan esok, macam manakah, apakah hari yang terbaik yang you nak esok? So you design lah, bangun pukul apa, nak buat apa, nak achieve apa pada hari tu. And then dia kena mula dengan experimentation dululah kalau tak biasa kan. And then you adjust sampailah you dapat apa nama tu, dapat the day that you want. Ataupun katakanlah 50% of the day that you want. Itu pun dah cukup baik dah. 50% is better than zero kan. So that's my advice. Get enough rest and also eat good food jugalah. Pasal kadang-kadang makanan yang kita makan pun boleh menyebabkan kita rasa letih walaupun kenyang. Sebab makanan kita tak berkhasiat. So get enough sleep, eat good food. Exercise is another thing. Mungkin you rasa macam, exercise bukan buat kita lagi letih ke? In a way, yes. But sebenarnya exercise juga satu benda untuk nak mencergaskan badan. So rest, eat well, exercise sikit. And then you kena ada schedule. Barulah you boleh belajar dengan elok. Kalau you letih macam you cakap ni, memang payahlah nak belajar. Sorry cakap, memang payah nak belajar. Oi, ada soalan? Macam mana nak move on daripada kisah lalu yang menghantui fikiran? Cara nak move on adalah berdepan dengan benda yang you nak move on tu. You kena berdepan dahulu dengan dia. Kalau you buat salah dengan orang, berdepan dengan dia. Minta maaf elok-elok. Kalau you trauma ke apa ke, berdepan dengan memori trauma tu. Proses trauma itu dengan baik, barulah you boleh move on. You tak boleh move on kalau you jenis nak suppress sahaja memori tersebut. Ataupun sekadar nak sembunyikan sahaja masalah itu. Ataupun sekadar nak larikan diri sahaja daripada isu itu. You tak boleh nak move on. Sebab isu masalah dia tak boleh nak hilang daripada kita unless and until kita selesaikan ia dengan betul. Sebab itulah orang pergi jumpa kaunselor, sebab itulah orang pergi masuk terapi, sebab dia ada masalah-masalah lalu yang belum selesai. Itu salah satu sebab lah, bukan the only reason. Itu salah satu sebab kenapa orang jumpa kaunselor, orang jumpa clinical psikologi, sebab dia ada masalah-masalah lalu yang dia tak settle lagi. Dia hanya ibarat macam dia sapu sampah bawah kapet, lepas tu tinggal kat situ. Sampah masih ada. Kok mana pun sampah tu masih ada. So you kena buang balik sampah tu daripada bawah kapet tu dan buang sampah tu di tempat sepatutnya. Baru lagi boleh move on. Kalau tak, dia still akan ada di situ. Dia hanya tunggu masa je nak timbul balik. So kalau nak move on, yeah, you kena deal dengan benda tu. Walaupun perit, walaupun pahit, walaupun sakit, itulah ubat dia. Ubat tak semestinya kena manis, betul tak? So kalau you perlukan pertolongan, apa yang saya cakap tadi, you jumpa kaunselor. Jumpa kaunselor dan cuba dia panggil talk therapy lah. Bercakap tentang benda tu supaya you boleh nak analisa dengan elok. Susun you punya pemikiran dengan elok supaya you boleh insyaAllah move on. Macam mana nak menegur setengah orang yang terlalu taksub dengan parti politik? Kita bagi nasihat, dituduhnya kita macai, kafir dan sebagainya. Okay, Syafiq. Alright. Tak semua orang boleh kita berdiskusi. Diskusi yang sehat memerlukan kerjasama kedua-dua belah pihak. Kalau you seorang je yang produktif, dia tak ada gunanya. So kalau pihak B tidak bersedia untuk nak berdiskusi dengan matang, bagi salam, jalan je. Jangan kutuk dia. Jangan panggil dia pula macai. Jangan buat cai pasal. Just senyum, assalamualaikum. Tinggalkan sahaja perbincangan itu. Kerana perbincangan itu tidak produktif. Perbincangan yang produktif ni dua-dua pihak kena ada, walaupun sedikitlah open mindedness untuk nak mendengar pihak yang satu lagi tu. Kalau dia tutup otak dia, dia just cakap, tak ada. Kau ni pihak B. Kau ni geng dia. Aku tak nak dengar kau cakap apa. Dan kita macam mana? Kita bukannya boleh kontrol dia punya pemikiran. So kita hanya boleh bercakap dengan orang yang sudi dengar. Kalau orang tu tak sudi dengar, tak apa, tak apa. Kita biarkan dia sahaja. Tidak bermaksud dia tak akan dengar langsung. Mungkin kita masalah dia. Maksud dia apa tahu? Mungkin dia tak nak dengar cakap kita. Mulut kita ni. Mungkin dia akan dengar cakap orang lain. Walaupun mesej orang lain tu sama dengan mesej kita. Kena ingat tu. So jangan kita berfikir negatif sangat. Kadang-kadang kita bukanlah orang terbaik untuk nak sampaikan mesej itu. Alright? Mungkin orang lain boleh sampaikan mesej yang sama kepada orang itu dan orang itu sudi dengar. So kita kena selalu ada that optimism tu. How do you change from studying to pass to studying to understand? Oh, very good question. How do you change from studying for grades and studying to understand? This is something that I personally faced when I was in university. So when I was in university, I had this very huge transition, internal transition, where I started to focus more on understanding the topics and materials rather than focusing more on getting good grades. But, okay, I have to say, but that transition period in my life, in a way, was a big factor that my grades in university weren't that great. Like if I were to show you my university transcript, you probably be like, apa ni Aiman, kau ni bengat rupanya. Yeah. And I'm not ashamed of what I went through. I'm not proud of my grades, but the experience is not something that I regret. No, because whatever that I have went through in my life, it made me who I am today. So let me be clear, I'm not proud of my grades, but I don't regret the experience. Know the difference? Okay. Now, how? Okay, first of all, you have to make a big decision. You have to make a big decision because this decision will affect not only you, but your parents, how you deal with people, and people's perception of you. So you have to hear me carefully. And this decision is your decision. But before you take this decision, you have to think about it very carefully because the effect is long-term. All right, what are the things that you have to think about? If you focus on studying to understand, there is a chance that it will affect your grades negatively, like what happened to me. But maybe for you can have both. You can have understanding and the grades. If that's for you, alhamdulillah, just keep on moving, man. Keep on moving. But let's just say that you make a decision, all right, from today forward, my focus is I am going to class focusing on the knowledge, focusing on enjoying the process of understanding this knowledge at a deeper level, and then applying the knowledge in my daily life. And that process, especially for me lah, personally, it affects my grades. So it's not an easy decision. It's not an easy decision. So you have to think about it. I have to think about it. And you have to make that conscious choice. When you go to your class, the next class, you have this different intention. You're not going to your next class with the intention, I'm going to get a dean's list. Even though there's nothing wrong with that, but your intention, your main intention is for you to understand this knowledge so that I can apply this knowledge so that I could benefit myself and other people with this knowledge. That was my intention back in university. And that's the same intention that I have today. And that's why I'll be using my psychology knowledge doing all this. It starts from there, from that university days. Again, I have to warn you, this is not like a heroic and like a path that's paved with roses. No. This is a very difficult path to go through because when my grades go down, I have to talk to my parents about it and obviously they're not happy about it. So I have to find a way to negotiate that with them. Then I have to face like people around and I have to, like when I was trying to apply for my master's degree, my application was in the beginning it was not accepted because, you know, my CGPA at the time was 2.5. But I managed to couple that CGPA with my work experience, and that enabled my CGPA to go up enough for me to be eligible to enter the master's program. But you know, the professors who are in charge of like getting me in, they're like, "What did you do in university? You got only 2.5 CGPA," and I did not have the time to explain to them from A to Z, like my internal transition and everything. But you know, you have to face the people, because you know the people's face when they don't believe in you. You know that face? They're like, "Well, I got 2.5 CGPA because I'm trying to focus more on understanding the knowledge." And they have this face, the yoke punya face. And it's not pleasant. But as long as you stay true to your words, you're not lying. It's true. It's coming from here. And you just keep on moving, inshallah, you'll do fine. And by the way, now in my master's degree, my grades are fine. It's just during that transition period, it's difficult for me to adjust focusing on understanding and focusing on the grades. I can't focus on both. For me, I can't focus on both. But now, alhamdulillah, somehow I managed to have good grades and also understand what I'm learning. So it's just a matter of like adjustment. Why banyak soalan? How to fight off despair? Rexus 666. That's a very difficult question. I don't have an easy answer, but I could give you a guideline. Study the dua of istikhara. The dua of istikhara. Istikhara is about choice. It's not about marriage. It's about choice. And when you make a choice, you ask Allah to basically bless your choice, or just ask Allah for some guidance lah, whether this choice is right for you or not. And sometimes you get what you want, and sometimes you don't get what you want. The thing is, when you get what you want, it's fine. You say, "Alhamdulillah, Allah answered my prayer, oh my God." But what happened when you don't get what you want? And that's when you'll be like, "Why don't Allah answer my prayer?" And that's why you have to really study the dua of istikhara. Because in that dua, if you study the dua of istikhara carefully, you will find the answer to why you don't get what you want. That's the key thing. And inshallah, that could be the remedy to despair. I've used it for myself. Like whenever I don't get what I want, I don't get what I hope for, I remember dua of istikhara and I realize that, you know what? It's okay. It makes it easier for me to move on. Ada tak tips yang mudah untuk hafal teori? Faham teori tu. Jangan hafal. Macam mana nak kawal rasa mengantuk dalam kelas? Tidur dengan cukup dan make sure you belajar benda yang interesting. Ataupun you cari something interesting tentang benda you belajar tu. You kena apply dengan you punya life. Kalau you tak nampak macam mana nak apply apa you belajar dengan you punya life, you tak nampak relevant dia, benda tu akan jadi kering. Benda tu akan jadi berat. Benda tu akan jadi boring. Contoh, dulu statistik bagi saya boring. Sebab saya tak nampak apa guna benda ni. But waktu master's degree, last semester saya belajar statistik balik. And saya masuk kelas tu dengan a different type of perspective lah. And from there, obviously you kena like guna letih sikit lah otak you nak mencari titik sambung dia antara statistik dengan life. Tapi saya jumpa sambungan dia tu. And then I realised that, oh, saya boleh apply statistik kat sini, kat sini, kat sini. And suddenly statistik jadi interesting. So you kena cari sambungan dia dengan you punya life. Baru you rasa benda tu interesting. Saya biasa tidur lambat. Lagi-lagi time weekend, sebab time malam memang macam senang masuk ilmu tu berbanding siang.
Okay.
Tapi tidur kurang dari 4 jam akan affect body system kita, as in low blood pressure. Okay, saya tak tahulah belah tu. Kalau you student medic, you tahu kot. So, quality badan akan low, cepat penat. So, macam mana? Nak study time pagi-pagi tu takut tak terjaga. So, in psychology, bilakah waktu sesuai untuk study yang sangat-sangat efektif? Soalan dia. Personally, saya tak boleh nak bagi tahu. Like, okay, waktu inilah yang sesuai untuk nak belajar. Tapi apa yang saya boleh bagi tahu adalah waktu paling sesuai untuk belajar adalah bila otak you paling fresh. Simple guideline lah. Bilakah waktu tersebut? Payah saya nak bagi tahu off the top of my head dia punya scientific study dia, sebab saya tak boleh ingat buat masa ni. Ada orang kata pagi, ada orang kata. So it's difficult lah. Kalau ditanya ramai orang, mungkin banyak lah dia punya jawapan dia. But dia punya petua dia adalah bila otak you fresh, you are ready to learn. You are ready to learn. Okay? And cubalah bangun awal. I mean memang susah pun, but then cubalah. Takkan nak give up cepat ke tak? Ya Allah, 437 dah. Saya sebenarnya nak pergi tempat lain buat ni. So okay. Banyak gila soalan. Dah lah, soalan ni pula lagi. Okay. Macam ni. Saya akan habiskan soalan dekat chat tu dulu, sebab soalan kat chat ni dia akan hilang. Sebab after live stream ni dia akan hilang terus. Soalan ni saya akan simpan. Mungkin saya buat lagi kot YouTube live stream ni. Alright, sebab saya nak kena pergi tempat lain pula. Okay. Macam mana nak atasi ibu ayah yang overprotective dan overthinking? Macam mana nak yakinkan mereka sebagai seorang anak? Oh, just refer balik yang story yang saya bagi tahu tadi tu. Kunci dia adalah you kena faham hati budi mak ayah. Kena belajar psikologi sikit lah. Tak belajar psikologi pun tak apa. You kena pandai mendengar. Kena pandai mendengar. Dan bukan setakat dengar perkataan-perkataan dekat mulut ni. Tak, you kena dengar juga dia punya emosi dia. Kena dengar juga kerisauan dia. Kena dengar juga dia punya niat di sebalik tu. Obviously you tak tahu for sure lah niat orang kan, benda tu right. But tapi you boleh dapat clue sikit yang oh, ayah aku ni sebenarnya risau. Oh, ayah mak aku ni sebenarnya dia paranoid sebab dia takut yang anak dia mungkin cedera ke apa ke. Once you faham benda tu, then you kena masuk selami dunia mereka supaya you boleh hargai dari mana datangnya perbuatan mereka itu. Alright? And from there, barulah you kena cari strategi macam mana you nak masuk. Alright? Macam mana nak masuk, nak dapat kepercayaan mereka tu supaya mereka sudi untuk mendengar apa you nak cakap pula. Okay? Strategi. So jangan fikir aku cakap sepatah, kau dengar sepatah. Tak. Manusia ni kompleks. You pun tahu you kompleks kan? You pun susah nak dengar cakap mak ayah, betul tak? Ha, kalau you pun susah nak dengar cakap mak ayah lagilah susah nak dengar cakap you. So, you kena pandai main strategi macam mana nak memenangi hati manusia. Barulah you boleh menangi telinga dia orang. Kalau you tak menang hati dia, you tak menang telinga dia. Macam mana nak jadi heartless? Kenapa you nak jadi heartless? You need a heart. It's good. Jangan jadi heartless. It's not a good life. No. Any advice for psychology student? Understand what you are studying. Truly, betul. This is like bunyi cliche lah kan. But as a psychology student myself, sedih menengok orang yang belajar psikologi tapi dia belajar setakat hafal dapat A. Sebab ilmu yang you belajar tu bro dan juga sis, oh my god, kalau you boleh apply and guna untuk bantu masyarakat kan, you can be like superpower, you know. So you understand what you're learning and apply. Jangan main copy paste je tau. Understand and apply dalam kehidupan you. You nampak magic dia. Pandangan anda tentang brother Aiman Bana. Wish, apa soalan ni? Aiman Bana kawan aku kot. Pandangan anda tentang brother Aiman Bana? Ya, dia kawan saya. You're defying the fact that grades equal knowledge. No, I don't believe that. Grades does not equal knowledge. Sorry. Grades does not equal knowledge. Okay. Maybe the answer is not sufficient. Proof. How many people who can't do well at school, but they do well in life? Also, reverse. How many people do well in school, but they don't do well in life? So, maybe the concept of knowledge tu kot yang lain antara you dengan saya. Mungkin. But I appreciate your point of view. Really, I appreciate your point of view. Thank you. Okay, dah cukup. Saya betul-betul kena keluar sekarang. Saya ada appointment dengan orang lain. Berapa lama nak belajar English dengan full lancar? Saya pun tak tahu. Saya start dah well, macam semua orang lah start. Saya start mula BI waktu darjah 1 macam semua orang. Sama je. Cuma beza dia adalah number one, saya suka BI and number two, saya praktis banyak. And of course, banyak buat silap, banyak apa terbabas, biasa-biasa lah tu. Berapa lama exactly saya tak tahu. Tapi yang penting adalah kalau you tak start sekarang, sampai bila pun takkan sampai tempat tu. Ha, itu dia. Okay, okay dah lah tu. Alright, assalamualaikum semua. Terima kasih kerana join saya pada petang ini. Ada banyak aja soalan. So insyaAllah saya buat lagi kot YouTube live streaming ini. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum. Mana button end dia? Oh sudah, tak jumpa dah. Mana? End stop broadcast.